Hey, how you doing? This is RJ. Today, I'm going to complete a request that I got a long time ago. Someone asked me to talk about Mary Sue's in connection to storytelling, and I'm going to do it in connection to comic books and that kind of storytelling, because you see Mary Sue type characters within comics, especially the big two of Marvel and DC, all the time now. Now, when you look at the term Mary Sue itself, it's a fairly recent term. As far as I remember, it is from a story written by a woman, and this story was a piece of Star Trek fan fiction, and her main character's name was Mary Sue. And this character was an officer on a starship, and she could do anything. And not only could she do anything, she could even do the jobs of her superior officers better than they could do their jobs themselves. And not only that, but she was also loved by everyone, and all of the guys fawned over her. And this is where the term originates from, this character of Mary Sue. But I don't think this is the full definition of what a Mary Sue actually is, because there is something about a Mary Sue that really, really gets under people's skin. And that's the thing that I want to concentrate on today and talk about, because these Mary Sue type characters, they just irk people. They are despised by a number of people, and I would say rightly so. And I want to look at why these characters are despised. And I'm going to, as usual, go back to these old definitions, these traditional definitions, and to describe why these types of characters are despised according to these old definitions. And I would say the reason why these Mary Sue characters are despised so much is because they are vainglorious characters. That is to say, they are opposed to glorious characters. They don't have glory, they have vainglory. They don't seek glory, they seek vainglory. Now, I know that these are not terms that are typically used in modern language, so I'm going to have to take a couple of steps back and talk about glory and what it is and how vainglory is similar in appearance, but is in actuality very different. So, let's look at glory. And we'll look at it according to a couple of comic book characters. The old definition, the traditional definition of what glory is supposed to be, it is supposed to be a manifestation of your good to the world so that other people can see it. And that is what glory is supposed to be. Now, let's look at a couple of comic book characters and flesh this out, because there is actually two different ways that glory is manifest within a story, as opposed to within real life. When you have a story and you have a character, let's take Superman as our example, all right? Superman is a glorious character within the universe, but at the same time, he's also a glorious character to the people who are reading the story. Now, if you go back to many of the different versions of Superman, you'll see that he tried to be a hero in the shadows at first, and it didn't work for him, and so he went back to Ma and Pa Kent, and she gave him the uniform and said, "No, you can't be in the shadows. You have to wear this flashy thing and be out there and be a symbol of hope to people." And that is him being glorious. He is a glorious hero. He is manifesting his goodness to the world so that other people can see it, and he's doing it for a very specific reason. He's doing it so that he can be a symbol of truth, of goodness, and of hope to the people around him in his world. That's exactly why he is a glorious character. Now, at the same time, the authors of these stories are typically taking Superman and using him and manifesting his glory, not just in the world itself that they are describing, but to us, the reader, as well. And so, he becomes a glorious character to us. And he is a glorious character so that he can present that truth, that goodness, and that hope to us as well. Now, it doesn't always have to work this way. If you look at another character like Batman, it works a little bit different, because in-universe, Batman doesn't want to have glory. It is something that is opposed to how he can actually stay alive, because he wants to stay in the shadows. He wants to stay in the dark, because he fights these criminals, who are a superstitious lot, and he wants to prey upon their ignorance of him and their superstition and turn it into a fear so that he can use it as a weapon against them so that he can defeat them, because he's just a man, and that's all he is. And that's what Batman is centered around. He's supposed to stay in the dark for that reason, so he can't be glorious in world. But at the same time, just like Superman, your authors, Typically, if we exclude Tom King, your authors are taking Batman and are making him a glorious character, not in his own world, but to us, the reader. And again, you have Batman, and he is an example, a shining example of justice to us out here in the real world. So he is, in some sense, a glorious character, but just to us, not to the people within his own universe. But if you look at vainglory, well, what is vainglory? Well, vainglory is exactly what the name implies. It is manifesting your goodness to the world so other people can see it, so that you can feed your own vanity. That is the reason why. Because if you look at a character like Superman, he doesn't care about that glory. He doesn't want glory for glory itself. He wants glory so that he can be a shining example of hope and truth to the people around him. And that's why he does it. And when you look at it that way, you'll see that glory is supposed to lead directly into honor. Actually, older philosophers have said the quickest path to honor is glory. So glory is tied up with this idea of honor, tied up with this idea of virtue. And when you look at all of those old ideas and what they actually mean, they are all pointing towards some greater good, some objective good out there in the world, some good that transcends both you and me and all individuals. It exists by itself out there. And those characters are serving that good. They want to be glorious in order to serve that good. If we go back to the ancient definition of honor, the one given by Plato in 400 BC, he said that honor consists in following the better. Well, what does that imply? Well, that implies that there is a scale that you can know and everybody can know of good, better, best. And that can only occur if there is an objective good that everybody can know. And so you can then put this scale of good, better, best. And therefore you can choose the better, and therefore you can be honorable. And one of the ways that you can gain honor and follow the better is through glory. So this idea of glory, it is tied up with this idea that there is this objective greater good that you can reach for. But when you look at these Mary Sue type characters, that's not what they reach for. They reach for this glory in order to feed their own vanity. And there's no wonder why these characters are doing this. All you got to do is look at some of the statements that are coming out of, let's say, Marvel. You have the Vice President of Content and Character Development saying at Marvel that these characters, these superheroes, especially these new quote-unquote superheroes, they shouldn't be reaching for ideals. What they should be doing is concentrating on exploring their own identity, and that they should be pushing this positive idea of exploring their own identity to that audience. So you see, that old idea of honor and glory and virtue, they're all centered around this idea of an objective truth, this ideal that people reach for. But no, at Marvel, they don't want any of that. They're saying that these heroes should not reach for an ideal. What they should do is concentrate on exploring themselves and their own identity. That is to say, they should concentrate on selfish things, on vain things. And what more, they should be taking that concentration on themselves and their own identity, these vain things, and that's the idea that they should be presenting to the audience as well, to, and this is a direct quote, push positive ideas to their audience. And if this is what they're asking both their characters to do and their audience to take in, what they are selling you is vain glory. This is not glory, because glory would be a service to some greater good, but these ideas are serving only the selfish, and therefore they are vain glory. Now, even with that, we still don't get to the heart of why these Mary Sue type characters are actually so offensive. And in order to do that, I'm going to have to take even another step back and see why these characters are actually being vainglorious. Now, typically, again, within your traditional way of thinking, the reason why people are vainglorious is because of pride. Vainglory, in the poetic sense, is said to be the daughter of pride. And what is pride? Well, when these older thinkers, they talk about pride, they talk about you presenting yourself to the people around you in a false way. That is to say, you are telling them a lie about yourself so that you can be praised not for who you actually are, but for the lie. And that leads straight into vainglory. And typically, this pride is expressed in three different ways. Number one, you could be claiming that you have some ability or something within you that you don't actually possess. So you are being boastful and hypocritical and lying about what you actually possess and asking people to praise you for that lie. So that's number one. But you can also have a person who is taking what they actually have and saying, praise me for it. And they do have this thing. They do have this quality. They do have this ability. And saying praise me for it. But they're saying praise me for it because I have acquired this thing all upon my own merit and no one else has helped me. And if you have any experience of life, you would know that that's a straight up lie. Every last person depends upon everyone else and depends upon standing upon the shoulders of the people who came before you to give you what you have, whether it be the parents who conceived you or the people who brought you up or the ancestors that brought you to the country where you live or the forefathers that built that country or the damn little farmer who feeds you every day by working himself like a slave out in the field. We all know that each and every one of us is standing on the backs of a multitude of other people, and that's the only reason that we have been able to get what we have. But no, this form of pride is saying that, no, I achieved this thing all upon my own merit, and I want you to praise me not just because I have this superior quality, but I want you to put another layer of praise on top of that because I have achieved this thing all upon my own merit, and no one else has helped me. So that is another form of pride. And this directly leads into the third way that pride is typically expressed. It's the fact that if I claim that I have this ability and I have gotten it on my own merit and no one else has helped me and no one else is like me, therefore no one else can have this quality and therefore I can turn around and look at everybody else and look down upon them and say, I have this thing, you will never possess it, therefore praise me even more. Now, if you look at what I would say the greatest example of these Mary Sue characters in comics is, which is Kate Bishop's Hawkeye, you can see all of this playing straight out. Because you have this little girl, this very small woman, and she's probably like 90 pounds, maybe 110, and she's fighting off a room full of these guys, these burly men, who look to be like 200 to 220 pounds minimum. And she has no superpowers, and sometimes she doesn't even use the bow. But that's a straight up lie. We all know that that is not true. That doesn't actually happen. If she were really, really well trained in some kind of self-defense that is directed specifically towards women, she might be able to get out of it once, maybe twice. But she's not going to get out of it time and time and time again without a scratch, which she does all the time. So if you take a real look at what is going on, you can see that that's a lie. She doesn't possess these qualities that the author is telling you to praise her for. Now, quickly, I would say that this is why you see these odd scenes within comics today, where you have this fight scene where it looks like it's about to start. You know, you see Kate Bishop with her arm raised, and she's about to punch this 200-pound guy and take on all of the guys behind him. And then all of a sudden, it cuts to the next page where all of the men are laying on the floor, and she's standing there wiping her hands off, and they're groaning and are defeated. Why do they do that? Well, they do that because they know that if they put this actual fight scene in, everybody would look at it and say, yeah, that doesn't actually happen. No, she can't actually do that. There's no way she can do that. Or if they put it in so that she fought in a way that women can typically fight in order to defeat larger men, and that would be usually to fight dirty and get hurt in doing it, well, if you put that in, that would be saying that women are different from men and that she can't actually hold toe-to-toe, blow-to-blow, fist-to-fist with these guys, and you can't do that. Not with these characters, not with these female characters, because that would be saying that they're different, and they will not do that. And therefore, since they will not do that, and they can't actually show the fight scene because they can't put it on the page and make it look like she's doing these things, which we all know that that size of a woman cannot do, because it is a lie. Because they will be exposed as telling a lie if they put it on the page. Now, even if we took that to be true, even if we said she has all of those merits and all of those talents, at the same time, they are trying to sell you this character as if this is all her own merit. She doesn't have any help from anybody whatsoever. And you can not only see this in the storytelling, but in this constant affirmation of the main character. You have all of these supporting characters saying, oh, you're so great. How can you do that? And she stands back and goes, yeah, I am so great, aren't I? This, again, is a straight up lie. It's her saying that not only does she possess all of these qualities, but she possesses them on her own merit and solely on her own merit. She doesn't say, no, this is all my training that I got from Clint Barton or any of the other heroes, because she doesn't have any of that. So it's a lie. Again, it's a lie. And this leads into the third part of the pride that you see on the page, because Typically, you do have Clint Barton standing next to her in most of her books. And what does she do? Well, she looks down upon him. And to be fair, most of the writers write Clint Barton as an ineffectual idiot in most of these comics, but that's all she does. She looks down upon him. And this is not just this character. If you look at other characters like Tony Stark, you have other characters like Captain Marvel always looking down upon him, always bad-mouthing him. Even if they go to him for help and ask him for technology or money and he gives it to them, they still bad-mouth him and they still look down upon him. And you can see this all over the place. I just did last month a 10-second comic review of Moon Girl and Devil Dinosaur, where you have this little girl, this 9-year-old girl, who said not only to be a super genius, but the smartest person in the Marvel Universe. And she's talking to Thor, and she's talking down to him, calling him a meathead, this being that's been around in the Marvel Universe for millennia. And you have this 9-year-old girl, who is a Mary Sue, talking down to him, calling him a meathead. Now, all of these things, they come from this expression of pride. And this pride comes from a lie that is told to you about who these characters are and what these characters can do. That's what it is. It's a lie. And that lie leads straight into vainglory. And these characters are not glorious characters. They're vainglorious characters. And yet still, we haven't gotten to the very heart of why these characters are so despised. Because the thing is that you can even take that type of character that I just described, and you can put them in a story, and it will not break the story, and they will not be despised characters if something else happens. And I've seen this typically within manga and anime. If you look at certainly isekai, stories like Tanya the Evil, or Overlord, or ReZero, stories like that, where you have these characters, and they're being praised, they're being glorified for all of these qualities, these abilities that the people around them think that they have, but they don't actually have. And they know that they don't actually have them, but they can't tell the people around them that they don't possess these abilities or these qualities. Now, that doesn't break the story in those cases. Why? Because we, the reader, know that this is not the case. We can see that this is not the case. And typically what it does within a story is it serves to be a source of humor. And you have this story that either becomes a comedy, or it is a story that is, say, action-adventure with a heavy dose of comedy. Because we, the reader, we can pick out that, yeah, this is not actually true. And so it becomes a comedy. So what is the thing that actually makes these characters so despised? What makes these Mary Sues so hateful as characters? Well, the thing is that it is the author of these stories taking these characters, these vainglorious characters, and not just selling them to the people around them in-world as if they were a hero, but taking these characters and using that in-world so-called glory to sell them to you as if they were glorious. But they're not glorious. They're vainglorious. So they're selling this idea to these characters in the world based upon a lie. And therefore, they are trying to sell these characters to you upon a lie as well. It's not like those anime stories where you are part of the in-joke and you know that this isn't actually the case. No, not at all. These writers are trying to deceive you into believing that these characters are glorious characters. And the way that they are doing it is through that lie of pride. And so these authors, they are directly trying to deceive you and me, who are the reader, through a lie. And that's why it is so offensive to see these characters. Because if you are able to pick out the fact that, no, these things aren't actually true, you know somewhere in the back of your mind that since these things are not actually true, what the author is trying to do is trying to deceive you and is lying to you. And if there's one thing that people don't like, it's being lied to and it's being deceived. And the despised quality of these Mary Sue characters comes directly from the fact that you have an author who not only takes this character that is boastful and arrogant, and they try to sell that to the people around them in the story as if they were a glorious character, but these authors are actually taking that happens within the story, and they're trying to sell it to you as well. And that's a statement on the author's part that says that you, the reader, you are stupid enough. You are just gullible enough for me to feed you the lie that this boasting, hypocritical character is actually a hero. So, if I've given you anything new to think about, hit like, hit the shield in the lower right-hand corner of your screen to subscribe, and leave me a comment. Tell me what you think about all this. All right, I'll see you later. Bye.